Hi, everyone. Good evening.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me okay? Great. So we're co-executive directors of Indivisible. My name is Ezra Levin. I don't think any relation to Kramer Levin. Leah Greenberg.
And we're so grateful to be here with you tonight. We should say before we get started that we're married. Before we get started, we should also say that we're married because sometimes we forget to mention that until like midway through the story, and it's super weird for people who are trying to follow along.
Few people are like, whoa, those co-executive directors are awful close. So we're being upfront about it. I think the way we'll do this, we actually normally do individual speeches, so this is, you're going to see some tugging and pulling here, but I think what we want to cover here is kind of how this crazy Google Doc became something that took over our lives and what happened over the last 9 months. I'll go over some stage setting. Leah can cover exactly what the impact of all these groups has been, and then we'll talk a little bit about what comes next, what we plan the organization to do going forward, and what we hope to say. So we heard earlier what we were doing at 2 a.m. that election night. We had been knocking on doors in Philadelphia, had come home to throw one of the worst house parties that we have thrown to watch the returns. And I think Leah was making a list at 2 a.m. that night on what to do next. I was asleep. And what came out of that was what we saw actually happening all over the country. People were pulling their own friends and family members together in their living rooms to try to figure out, what do you do in this breaking world? How do you productively engage? I'm sure many of the folks in this room were doing the same thing. And one thing we saw almost immediately was there was a ton of energy out there. Folks were trying to find ways to get engaged in their own communities, trying to find ways to engage at the national level, to somehow fight back against an agenda that they did not agree with, to make their voice heard as constituents. And we were actually back home in Austin, where I'm from, for Thanksgiving, meeting with a friend from college who had been newly awoken to this world of civic engagement. And we heard from her what we're hearing from others, which is, we've got a whole bunch of folks together. And she was an administrator of this new group. It was Dumbledore's Army, for those of you who follow Harry Potter. And it was focused on getting people engaged for the first time. And they knew about signing petitions, they knew about making calls, but how any individual one of those actions could connect to this overall, this huge goal of affecting what's possible at the national level was less clear. And so Leah and I were former congressional staffers, and don't hold that against us, we haven't been in a while, but we saw something that worked. We were there during the rise of the Tea Party, and we did not agree with the Tea Party's ideology, but we saw the impact they had. We saw the impact of organizing locally and applying your constituent power, going to your two senators, going to your representative, going in person, going to district events, going to district offices, making calls. That changed what was possible at the national level. Though we didn't agree with it, we saw the impact of it. And so looking at where we were in mid-November and early December, we thought, look, as former congressional staffers, we don't really have very many skills, but we do know how Congress works. We can talk about how Congress works. We can demystify how this opaque system actually operates, what members of Congress are actually thinking about when they make their decisions. And that's what we decided to do. That was the extent of our aspiration. We put together this 23-page Google Doc with an embarrassing number of typos that explained, here's what your member of Congress is thinking when they go to the district office. Here's what the member of Congress is thinking every morning when they wake up. It's re-election, even the good ones, because they've got to get re-elected to do the good they want to do. And here's how you as an individual, or you with a handful of people, can alter that thinking, can actually put pressure on the member of Congress locally by affecting the way that they're portrayed in local media, by affecting the way that they make these political choices at the national level. And we were sitting at the kitchen table one night eating soup on a Wednesday night, and I tweeted it out to my dozens of followers on Twitter, hoping that, you know, maybe our parents would like it on Facebook, maybe a few months later somebody would get in touch with us and say, hey, we really showed it to our member of Congress who went to this town hall and asked them some questions. That was the hope, that it would be useful to the energy that was already out there. And okay, so I've been talking a lot. Let's let Leah talk about what happened next.
within a couple of hours, it became clear that our wildest hopes had already been exceeded. We put it online around 7 o'clock, and by about 9 o'clock, Google Docs had stopped loading because so many people were trying to access this document, which was, you know, a stunning experience for us. We had no idea there was such an appetite for, you know, your thoughts on politics on the internet. We, more importantly than that, suddenly we were getting all of these emails from people. They just started streaming in the first night, and they didn't really stop after that. It was folks saying, I brought people together in my living room. We were trying to figure out what to do. We had no idea what to do. Now we found this guide, and we are now Indivisible Rochester, or we are now Indivisible Berkshire County. People were forming these groups all over the country, and the number one questions, well, two questions we got. Two points. One was, there's a typo in your document. There are a lot of really helpful people pointing out the typos in our documents. But the second, and more popular, was, I'm forming a group, so how do I find more people who are going to join with me, who are going to work with me in my community to do this? And so Ezra and I and a couple of the other folks who've been involved in writing the document, we quickly realized that we weren't on our own up to the task of responding to this wave of energy. So we started pulling in friends, colleagues, other people who just wanted to help. We built a website to house the document so that people could actually read it. And then we built a directory, and we said, hey, if you're going to be using this guide, list your group here. Give people a way to get in touch with you, and just, you know, commit to upholding progressive principles in your actions, and you're, you know, just register on our site. And you're independent, you do what you want, but just use this to find other people. When we put it online, we thought we'd maybe get about 100 groups. I remember saying, we talked about what success would look like, and I said, well, if we get 300, we'll obviously be overwhelmed. And we're now at about 6,000 groups. A minimum of 2 and an average of 13 in every single congressional district in the country. And that underscores something that's really important, which is, this is not just an East Coast, West Coast, major cities phenomenon. This is all over the country, and actually a lot of the really strongest and most spirited activism is going on in places that you don't associate with you know, blue state activism. It's Arkansas, it's West Virginia, it's Utah. It's folks who've come together and in fact formed really strong communities in places where they didn't necessarily have a way to find other progressives. One of the most common things that we heard from people was, I thought I was totally alone in my community, and now I have people who want to take action with me, and people who, I know that I'm not crazy. And the thing was, these groups that were registering with us, they weren't just, you know, registering on the internet. Within a couple of weeks, they started doing actions. They started the week after Trump was inaugurated, more than 10,000 people showed up outside of Senate offices all around the country to oppose Trump's cabinet nominees. And, you know, that was a powerful moment, not just because it was 10,000 people, but also because they were talking to both Democratic and Republican senators. This wasn't a purely partisan effort. This was expecting Democrats to uphold progressive values as well as Republicans. A lot of them were motivated actually specifically by the vote to confirm Mike Pompeo as CIA director, which had been a bipartisan vote and had featured a pretty significant Democratic support. And what we saw was, just a couple weeks later, an equally bad nominee came down, Betsy DeVos, and she was confirmed, but she was confirmed with no Democratic support, and with no Democratic support, and with Republicans opposing her. And that was the difference. The difference was constituent pressure. The difference was this wave of opposition that had come down in the couple of weeks between. And what we knew, because they were emailing us and asking for advice and asking for what to do next, was all these groups were just getting started. By February, when Congress people and senators started having town halls, and when thousands of people started showing up in Arkansas, in Iowa, in Colorado, all over the country, you know, the media was surprised. They were saying, sort of, where did all of these folks come from? But the reality was, all of those little groups that had formed in January in living rooms had started to come together and form bigger groups. And they'd all bought into this basic premise, which was that, you know, there's nothing about Donald Trump's agenda that depended on Donald Trump. It all depended on whether your member of Congress and your senators were going along with it. And they were determined to take action to change that basic political calculus. And the crazy thing was, it worked. What we saw over the last 6 months, especially with the Affordable Care Act fight, was constituent pressure had this extraordinary effect. It turned what was a campaign promise for Republicans for the last 7 years into a painful political liability over the course of really just a few months. Determined advocacy did that. One of the most striking moments for us in March, when the House voted down attempt to pass the health care vote paid, House attempt to repeal the Affordable Care Act failed for the first time, was you could draw a direct line between the places where we were in touch with super active groups that were working, you know, not just Indivisible groups, but working with Planned Parenthood, working with a bunch of other progressive activist groups to really pressure their members of Congress. So groups like Love Indivisible in Barbara Comstock's district in Virginia, groups like New Jersey 11th for Change in Representative Frelinghuysen's district, you could draw a direct line between the members of Congress who started to come out against that bill and the places where they had been experiencing really determined public constituent pressure. And we saw that as well when it headed to the Senate. What we saw was, over and over again, efforts to pass the bill were exposed to sunlight. Sunlight caused massive waves of constituent pressure, and each version of the bill that Republicans tried to advance ultimately failed under the weight of a really determined outreach across the progressive community, a really determined push to make that bill, turn that bill from something that had been the unified priority of a Republican government. That is not a Freudian slip. A unified federal government, and turn it into a painful political liability, and it worked.
Sure. Well, so just picking up off of that, there was, from our point of view and the way we were engaging in this activism, a big difference between the mass amount of activity we saw in February on the Affordable Care Act, just taking this as an example, and the mass amount of activity we saw in June and July, which ultimately is what sunk it, depending on what happened in the next couple of weeks. And that's that in February, we were getting emails from these groups, we were seeing in the news that they were going to town halls, we were giving them advice on how to do it, but fundamentally, they were doing it. They were driving it. And that's been the case throughout this time. We're, you know, happy to be here speaking to you, but there are 6,000 group leaders that are really leading this movement on the ground. They're calling the shots. Back in February, it was all volunteer. From the National Indivisible Organization standpoint, it was entirely volunteer. I remember in that first weekend that we brought everybody together because Google Docs was crashing, we were being overwhelmed with all this attention from groups on the ground and from other folks, and we brought folks into our living room, just friends and friends of friends into our living room to try to set up a website and to try to actually create a document that didn't have as many typos and all those things. And we needed somebody on social media. So we asked, who has a Twitter account? And somebody on the stairs raised their hand. They were in charge of social media. That was how the organization was formed. The organization was entirely volunteer run up through February, actually. And so, into March. And so for those first February recess events, we were cheering on the sidelines, and people were working during their lunch breaks and late into the night and on fake sick days, because that's the time they had. But we were really limited. It was an amazing experience, but it was also fundamentally not enough, and it wasn't sustainable. So what happened was we started building up an actual organization. We put a donate button up on the website. We started getting checks worth $15 from North Dakota in small towns, and they allowed us to actually take on staff to build up an organizing team and a policy team and a communications team. And the difference was really on display in that June and July timeframe when we were yet again fighting against the Affordable Care Act bill. But Mitch McConnell learned from the House experience. What he learned was that sunlight's the best disinfectant, and so the best way to get a bill that isn't really popular through is to do it in the dark. And that's what we saw. We saw very little sunlight on the bill once it got to the Senate. And so instead of us cheering from the sidelines and just watching what the groups were doing, we were able to form direct connections with the groups in key states, in key districts, and say, hey, there's an opportunity right now to make your voice heard. You have an ability to actually influence the, even though it's not in the headlines, even though this isn't on the front page, you should be doing this right now. And instead of just, again, watching, we're then flexing a muscle. We were able to have that direct connection to the groups on the ground and help provide strategic advice so they could actually exercise that power. And that's what we saw That's what we saw in June and July. That's how we, from our point of view, were able to actually fight, even though it wasn't in the headlines the same way it was back in March and April. So now we have, unexpectedly, this organization, really on the first page of that Google Doc. Lee and I both had jobs at that point that were separate from this. We said at the bottom of that first page, we're not professional advocates, our bosses don't really know about this, and our free time, we are not starting an organization. It's the last thing that we need to do. And then we started the organization in January. And the reason why we did was explicitly to respond to and support these groups on the ground. We have policy goals of our own that we would like to see enacted. We have our own political goals, but that's not why we started the organization. The organization exists to support this local leadership on the ground. And that's why, as we've built it up, it's not just been built up in DC and led from DC, it's been built up in coordination with these local groups to empower them, to help them drive it forward. And so that gets to what we're doing now.
Well, and I think that there's an important transformation on our own part that came in that process. We had advised people originally in the Google Doc, form a group, because groups are really good at pressuring members of Congress. They're more effective than you on your own. But what we didn't realize when we said that was people were seeking to come together in communities after the election. People were seeking a way to join into something that was more powerful than just their voice on its own. And in doing so, they were forming groups that could actually really have a meaningful impact for the future. And so it didn't take us long to realize that our long-term success was actually about ensuring the health, the sustainability, the effectiveness of these local groups and their own work and their partnerships within the broader progressive infrastructure. And so that's really the center of what we're trying to do now. We think that, you know, there are policy victories to be achieved, there are electoral victories to be achieved, but ultimately having local communities that are where you're building up local leadership, where you're building up the ability to organize, you know, not just for congressional priorities, but for any number of local and state campaigns as well, we think that's the way forward, and that's the way to start to rebuild some of the, to support and rebuild some of the progressive infrastructure that's absolutely critical in the long term to building political power.
And then, so just, I'd love to get to questions, but just piggybacking on that, one person we've been talking to for a while now, I don't know exactly how we got connected to him, back in January we started talking to him, this guy Marshall Gans. I don't know if folks know who he is. He was Cesar Chavez's organizing director for 18 or so years, and he's a professor of social change at Harvard, and he talks about this distinction between organizing and mobilizing, whereas mobilizing is traditionally what a campaign does, so get a group of people to do a thing. Vote for the ballot initiative, vote for the candidate. And then after that thing occurs, the energy dissipates. And that's all well and good for a campaign, because maybe you get your ballot initiative passed or you get your candidate elected. In contrast, organizing is different. Organizing is about building local power and local leadership. And mobilizing is a part of that. You can organize and then mobilize people to do stuff, but at the root of it, it is what Lee was talking about, building up this basic community-level progressive infrastructure from which you can mobilize, you can win legislative battles, you can try to elect candidates. So when we think of what Indivisible is doing right now, yes, there are these individual policy fights in the near term, but we're trying to take advantage of this opportunity to actually build something that's much longer term. And it's not about promoting any individual policy or any individual candidate. It's actually about building thousands of local leaders who can then rise to the occasion whenever one of these fights comes up. And it's why our unit of activism, and this is a bit different from a lot of other groups, our unit of activism isn't the individual. Individuals, their activism wanes. It's reasonable. They get new jobs, or they move, or they have kids. They can do it for a couple months, but then other things happen. That's fine. That's natural. But if your unit of activism is the group, you can be building up local leadership continuously. So one local leader might drop off, but then you've got another local leader to pop up and take their place. And that's key to what we're doing. So a big part of our challenge as we fight these individual fights from week to week and month to month is ensuring that it's not Indivisible National doing this, but we're building up that local power so that they're able to engage in that fight, whatever it might be. So why don't we stop there and go to questions, if that's okay. We'd love to dive into any issues that we didn't touch on, or if you raised anything that you disagree with, happy to jump into that too.
Have you heard from President Obama?
From Princeton to Boston. So, you know, we talk to him every day, obviously. No, actually. So, this is something we didn't talk about, and it is worth noting. We are not an arm of the Democratic Party, nor do we coordinate with the Democratic Party. It has been really important for us to be separate from the existing political infrastructure, and that doesn't mean that we don't coordinate with some politicians from time to time when we're all on the same page, but some of what we've done over these first 8 or 9 months is pressure Democrats to stand up for progressive values when they haven't been. And the fact that we are not part of that existing Democratic infrastructure allows us to do that. Have not talked to President Obama.
If he'd like to.
Yeah, happy to. I'll give you my cell afterwards.
Thanks.
Thank you. We're actually running a progressive campaign in New Jersey. This is Chris Ordway, my candidate. We're working with one of your groups. And my question to you is, how do we get that group to translate their energy into canvassing for us? Because we can raise all that money, but if nobody knocks on the doors with us, it's not going to happen.
Yep.
We'll have the same thing as we have now.
Great question. And so I'm going to let Leah answer it. Because the way we've split up the organization is we have 4 programmatic teams, the communications, policy, political, and field. Leah oversees political and field, so this is all on her.
So, I mean, I guess I would start by saying, you know, each group is independent, and so they do ultimately make their own decisions about whether they're going to get engaged, whether they're going to do both issue advocacy and electoral work. That said, what we've seen with most indivisible groups has been that they don't necessarily see a dividing line between those two things. It's not a huge leap to go from noticing that your elected representatives are doing a very bad job of representing you to looking for somebody who will. So I'm not sure what the specifics are in your situation, but we're actually working on rolling out a set of tools and trainings and resources for local groups who are seeking to get involved electorally. You know, not just about thinking about voter registration, thinking about how to do canvassing, how to work with campaigns, how to engage with candidates, so that you can assess whether you're going to make a decision for your group about getting involved. So we're working on getting a set of those sort of tools and resources out to folks. But that said, you know, lots of groups are not waiting for us. In Georgia 6, there were a ton of indivisible groups that were super involved in the electoral work. And in fact, in most of the special elections, we've seen at least some of the groups that have been in those areas get engaged and serve as very motivated volunteers.
And so, I mean, it is worth noting, the guide was entirely focused on legislative advocacy, and not just legislative advocacy, but congressional advocacy. But this funny thing happens when you get dozens or hundreds or thousands of people together in the same room focusing on how they can engage in the political debates of the day. They don't just stop with congressional advocacy. They start talking about elections, or they start talking about state and local, or they start talking about other ways to get civically engaged. And that's what the groups are doing. And so we started with this guide fully focused on congressional advocacy. We've released over 500 documents now on various pieces of either policy analysis or briefs or trainings that are specific on how do you talk to press, or how do you hold a constituent-led town hall if your member of Congress is hiding from you, or how do you engage on the various other stages that aren't specifically related to Congress. And so some of that we're supporting, but a lot of it is really being driven by the local groups.
You had talked about, this is about the healthcare bill, and you've talked about the this idea that it's not about a particular policy, it's about creating an organization or groups of organizations that are lasting. But I guess I have a two-part question.
Okay, so I guess you felt that in February, all the town halls were face-to-face interactions with your elected representatives were very important in the healthcare fight. And then you mentioned that McConnell learned to do it in the dark then, but then you said that. So we counseled the individual groups on how to approach that. And I was just kind of curious if you could just build upon what was it that you think that they did that influenced what happened with that failing at 49? And then as you look to this next leg of the fight, I guess there's Graham Cassidy Cassidy Graham that's just happened now, and to what extent are you engaged in it still or not, because it doesn't really fit your, you know, it's just one policy issue.
Oh no, as long as it's on the table, we'll be engaged with it.
Right.
But I'll let you talk about the health campaign.
So on health, so specifically on the Senate side, how that battle played out. So I think it was a battle on two fronts. One was ensuring the Democrats actually use every tool at their disposal to slow things down. McConnell's goal was to get this through before the July recess. That was the first goal. And Democrats, although they are in the minority, they have some tools at their disposal. They can filibuster and they can withhold consent, which doesn't totally kill the legislation happening in the Senate, but it does slow things down. So one effort was New York groups going to Chuck Schumer's office and saying, use every tool at your disposal, you need to be doing this, and focusing on other Democrats in leadership to do that. So that was one piece. Eventually the Democrats did start doing that. I think sometime after Father's Day, they started actually withholding consent from all bills to slow things down. And then the second piece was actually focusing on senators who we thought we could get, Republican senators who were expressing concerns about the legislation and maybe were convincible that this was a bad piece of legislation that was either would politically harm them or was just bad policy that they didn't want to get behind. So what we saw was in states like Maine with Susan Collins during that July recess, because we made it to July recess, she went to public parades and was approached by person after person who said, please do not vote for this legislation. I will be dead or bankrupt if it goes through. And she was one of the folks who came out against it. We had in Alaska, every single district office that Susan Murkowski has, upper Senate district offices, Indivisible groups visited on the same day asking her to vote against this. So that was a piece of the puzzle. It's not the only thing. You know, we're part of a larger fight. And I would caution folks, healthcare, the Affordable Care Act, one of the reads we see afterwards was that, it was just McCain that saved it at the very last. It almost got through were it not for that vote. But there were a series of votes over the course of the week. There were a series of different pieces of legislation, and a different combination of senators voted against different parts of these bills, which really did influence the final outcome. We would argue that it was a result of this constituent pressure that allowed those senators to buck leadership and ultimately move against the bill. And actually, one other thing, this was after the debate, one thing we really pushed hard was thanking those senators who did the right thing, both Democrats and Republicans. Lisa Murkowski had a, in Alaska, there was a airplane flying over saying, thanks, Lisa. Susan Collins, when she flew back to Maine, was greeted with hugs and thanks when she was in the airport. I think somebody went, I don't know how they found McCain's property, but they put up all these signs that said thank you on the property, which we didn't advocate. But that kind of outpouring of support makes it easier to do the right thing. Because, again, that we're not an arm of the Democratic Party, we can say, hey, just stand up for the right thing and we'll be behind you. And whether you're a Democrat or Republican, we're there for you if you are actually standing up for your constituents.
And I guess you guys are the central cell, so to speak. So
we call ourselves the central cell, yeah.
How many employees do you have? What's your budget? And who's your largest contributor?
Yeah. So our single largest contributor is small dollar donations, actually. Our average donation is less than $50.
But what's the largest, and who would that be from?
The largest donation that of the foundations that have given. So, I mean, I can say generally, so we will not accept over 20% of our budget from any individual source. We don't take corporate dollars, and we don't take money from political favors. That's not something we have to do. It's something we choose to do because we want to be as responsive as possible to the field. What was that? There was another
employees
question.
And size
of budget. Yeah, so we have 34 folks on staff now. Spread across those, mainly those four programs. About a third of the staff is in the organizing space. So there are organizers either based in D.C. or they're in the field. Like we have somebody in Texas or somebody in interstate.
So our budget for this year is about $5.1 million.
So first, thanks for what you're doing. It's amazing to hear about your success over such a short period of time. So thanks. My question is about the midterms. I understand that you're nonpartisan and that you're primarily issue-based and that you will work on issues and are specializing in congressional advocacy. But given the stakes for the 2018 midterm and the fact that issues often arise in Congress based on who controls it, obviously, are you thinking about getting more directly involved in electoral politics in 2018? Thanks.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, as I was saying, a lot of the local groups are already getting engaged. But what we are seeking to do is do a couple of different things. One is provide a baseline of tools, resources, trainings, and support to groups all over the country to engage, you know, and that's from deep red to deep blue and all the swing areas in between, empowering them to make decisions about, you know, how do they engage with campaigns, do they work directly, do they do their own advocacy work, do they do voter registration ahead of time, a lot of different ways that they can sort of build up their own civic power in the you know, months to come. And then also looking at targeted places where there's a combination of really strong group strength and then also pivotal congressional races in states that have key senatorial and key gubernatorial contests, especially on the gubernatorial side for redistricting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry. I've been ignoring this side.
Thank you very much for back here.
Oh,
yes, yes, thank you for what you're doing. Yeah. My name is Emily Martz, and I live in the northernmost district of our state, and it's the largest district in our state, and it's also a rather conservative district. Out of the 12 counties, 11 of them voted differently than I did in the presidential election. And a few days after the election, I and some friends started a group that eventually became an indivisible group when the opportunity arose. We're called Now What? And by January, February, we realized that across this district, there were over 40 groups that had arisen. And that's also including the women's huddles. And we saw the activity, and we started communicating with each other, and we realized we have a lot of common purposes, and we need to get to know each other. So I, with the help of some other people around the district, put together a day-long conference where four representatives from each of the groups came. We had over 112 people there, and it's ended up being a group that, and a consortium, if you will, a summit that has bred relationships that is now able to coordinate efforts around our district. So my question for you is this happening in other parts of the country, and are you thinking of spearheading this yourselves?
I swear we didn't pay her to ask that question, but we have such a ready answer to that. So we literally so we send a weekly email out to our whole list. The last one was announcing these regional institutes in the business school. That's not the official name. Leah, do you want to talk about the regional institutes a little bit?
Sure. So we're... I'll start with a couple of quick things. One, it is totally happening organically in a lot of places. And one of the things that we saw with the healthcare fight when we were, especially in targeted states, urging people to coordinate statewide actions was, you know, kickstarted a lot of relationship building and a lot of more statewide and regional coordination. There's, you know, a huge degree of variation. In some places there are, you know, basically statewide coordinating entities already, and in some places it's really not happened organically on its own. What we are doing right now is actually bringing folks together for regional institutes, bringing group leaders from neighboring states together for a combination of strategizing and training. So looking at, especially recognizing that many folks who have become active in the last 9 months are new to organizing and really, you know, are want and are seeking sort of nuts and bolts organizing skills that you don't necessarily get taught if you're not a professional organizer. And also thinking about, you know, how do we help people motivate and keep their own groups together? So we're actually, we've been working with Marshall Gans to design a curriculum that's really focused on helping groups do shared purpose training for themselves, or working with groups to do shared purpose training and then training the group leaders so that they can do that with their own groups. And then we're also, you know, we know that there's just a catalytic power to actually getting people together in the same place. When Ezra and I travel, we will often meet up with group leaders in different cities and states, and what we find is that even just the act of getting together with folks actually often kickstarts really cool collaborative efforts. So, yes, we absolutely have seen the same thing, and we're working to promote it.
Thank you. So the question is, the question is, what legislation, or how do you choose the legislation that you're championing? And how much diversity of opinion is there among the groups? For instance, in healthcare, we see kind of a split occurring on as to single payer versus incremental change, like Obamacare. That kind of thing. How top down is that? Is there a diversity of opinion among the groups?
That's great. Good question. We didn't cover that. Our this hits really at the core theory of change, and it is that, accepting this hard truth that progressives don't have the House, the Senate, or the presidency, which means we lack agenda-setting power. We can't set the agenda. There are other folks setting the agenda. What we have is the power to respond. What the reason why we call it indivisible, and Leah gets credit for actually naming it, was that we perceive that just about every facet, not just of the progressive ecosystem, of basic tenets of American democracy were under threat by this administration, Congress, which is our analysis. And you had two options in that situation. You could wait your turn. My background's in anti-poverty work. Leah worked on human trafficking. We have folks who were in the environmental space or the healthcare space. You could wait your turn and stand up for your issue, and you would wait your turn to lose. Or you could stand up and respond to whatever was under threat right now. So the way that we focus on an issue, the way we determine what we're recommending people focus on this week is, what is Congress and this administration doing right now? A typical congressional staffer has an attention span of give or take 2 or 3 minutes. And if you go in talking about something that's far down the line, it'll be in one ear and out the other. Your power as a constituent is a, I like the background, because it's great, now I'm getting pumped up. Your power as a constituent is the power to respond. It's a power to say, hey, this hearing is coming up on Thursday, or there's this vote on Friday. We expect you to vote this certain way, and if you don't, we're going to hold you to it. So that's how we determine what issue we're weighing in on a given week. There is diversity of opinion among the groups, and fundamentally, the groups are free to say, hey, we know that healthcare is at risk right now, but we really care about the Paris Climate Accord, and we want to do some more work on that. And they're free to do that. And they do have different opinions on whether, it should be one healthcare bill or another healthcare bill. The question for us right now is, what is under threat? What's going to be voted on, and how can you have an impact right now?
You're a 501c3.
C3 and C4.
I'm sorry?
C4 and C3.
Okay. And you say you'll take support, seek support from Republicans and Democrats alike. Allow me to make a guess of a high percentage of the people who are involved deplore Trump. I'm not asking you the number, but I assume that's true. So, being optimist, since you've done so much better than you thought at the start, imagine continued growth. When Trump is gone, whether 3 months or 3 years, what do you do when there's a successor Democratic administration? So is this just this moment, what you're doing? Or do you have longer-term plans?
So probably we'll go on vacation pretty immediately. But no, so what's interesting is that, the groups did come together because they were scared about what this administration's agenda said about what America was. They disagreed with that. That's why they're getting involved. But actually, a lot of the advocacy that's been done has not been just Trump. And in fact, one of the things that we try to drive home is that this agenda does not depend on this president. What it depends on is whether individual members of Congress go along with it or not. So it's fundamentally a question about the congressional agenda rather than the administrative agenda. Unfortunately, your power to affect the administrative agenda is pretty limited because Trump doesn't really care if you're out at a constituent office. Our hope and the way that we're investing in these groups, or the way we're supporting these groups, is not to create an anti-Trump force that dissolves as soon as the president changes, but to create, again, this basic infrastructure so that you can get engaged civically, yes, at the federal level, but also state and local, yes, on corporate pressure, yes, on all sorts of things, and we see groups doing that.
And I would add that I think a lot of folks who got engaged because they were appalled by Donald Trump and what he represented made that leap relatively quickly. So, we talk to groups all the time who they started off advocating to Daryl Issa, a representative from California in this wing district, to resist Trump, to take stands against the things that were coming down the pike legislatively. And now they're mad at Daryl Issa because he's not, he's voting for Trump care. He's voting for all of these priorities. And so people actually make that transition to understanding that, nothing actually depends on Trump. It all depends demands on a broader infrastructure that they have to stand against.